Hi. So now's Anup talking about the RISC-V hypervisor development.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. I guess I have 5 minutes less today, but anyways. Yeah, so I'm Anup. Actually, you already introduced me. So I'll skip that. But this talk is all about Western Digital's experience in co-developing RISC-V hypervisor support. It's more about how we contributed to the spec as such, and less about the software, because we already gave a lot of talks in past few months regarding the various hypervisors we have ported to. So we had a couple of talks in OSS ELC Europe, and we had one talk in RISC-V Summit recently as well. So I won't spend much time on the software part. In fact, no time. Yeah, and this is a brief outline of the talk. We'll first look at what it actually means by co-developing a RISC-V extension, then look at the edge extension in general, what is the details of the spec, and then move on to like what is the future work we are looking at in terms of RISC-V virtualization. So let's start with co-developing a RISC-V extension, and like we saw in the modeling, like very few people are actually familiar with RISC-V, so it's better to touch base quickly again. What is RISC-V? It's a free and open ISA. It's a clean slate, extensible ISA. It supports 32-bit, 64-bit, and in future 128-bit machine word length as well. It has 32-bit general purpose registers. It also supports instruction compression, variable error instructions. And it has three privilege modes. The picture over here shows the three distinct privilege modes. M is for the platform specific firmware or the microcontroller mode. And then there is a S mode for the OSs. Then there is a U mode for the apps. And we have control and status registers for each of these modes. We won't be talking in detail of each of them, but then the right-hand side table actually shows the CSRs typically used by Linux kernel or any operating system. Just any operating system or Linux just needs 8 CSRs, so it's pretty simple. So what is a RISC-V extension? So in general, RISC-V is not just one ISA, it's actually a set of ISAs. It's pretty modular, and each ISA in itself is targeted to a particular functionality, and we call each individual ISA as an extension. And we have a alphabetic letter assigned to each ISA. The most common and well-defined ones are like integer multiplication, division, atomic, single precision, floating point, double precision. And there is a special G, which actually represents general purpose, which is nothing, it's a pseudo letter, which represents I, M, A, F, and D extensions. And then we have C for compress instruction, then H for hypervisor, V for vector, and more are being defined in the pipeline. And Linux actually needs, we also have this notation actually in RISC-V, where we have a string representing given RISC-V implementation, and the string starts with an RV, which is a RISC-V, and then a number, which is the machine word length, and then a string of characters representing the supported ISAs or the supported RISC-V extensions. And examples are here, RV64 IMA, RV64 GC, and Linux or any general purpose operating system can pretty much depend on the below mentioned four types of stream, because like we any operating system cannot support all possible combinations of the RISC-V because of its modularity, of course. And so what it actually means to develop a new RISC-V extension, or what is the process of designing or defining a RISC-V extension? So it starts off with an initial draft and then goes for a lot of draft revisions, and then eventually it gets frozen, and then it enters in the ratified state. This whole process actually takes quite a few years actually, based on the experience with the existing extensions. So for RISC-V Foundation, the clear stand is that for any extension spec to reach the frozen state, enough experience has to be, we need enough experience or validation by both software and implementations. It's a very strict requirement so that to ensure that the RISC-V extension spec is long-lasting enough and it covers most of the things. But then because of that, it takes a lot of time to freeze it and ratify it. And by implementation, we generally mean any ASIC, FPGA, simulator, or emulator. And by software over here, we mean any firmware, Linux, hypervisor apps, or even bootloaders. And so RISC-V extension is generally a kind of a software or a contract between the implementation and the software. So what we did with the RISC-V hypervisor support is we did something called as co-development. And in general, for any RISC-V extension, this can be done. So what is a RISC-V extension code development? It actually means that once the spec or the draft spec of any RISC-V extension is in a functionally complete state, we can actually do the further revisions based totally on the experiences of implementation and the software. So we start very early, close to the after the, it is functionally complete, and we implement on FPGA or ASIC or simulator the RISC-V extension, and then also write software for it and try to validate or test on both sides to ensure the completeness. And in fact, we also discover a lot of limitations when we implement software or do some implementation. So the whole code development thing is all about having last few draft revisions only based on experiences of implementation and software. So this again further hardens the RISC-V, any RISC-V extension spec, and helps it to last long. So there is a challenge in this process, because since the spec is not frozen, it can change. And there is a fundamental cyclic dependency between any implementation and software. So we end up doing a lot of development with every draft revisions that we are doing in code development, which makes it very painful for the people involved. But yeah, it helps for long term. So moving on to RISC-V H extension, or the hypervisor extension as we call it. So this spec has been in development for more than 2 years now, and it's very close to free state. I mean, it's almost there. And the key contributors of this, the initial key contributors of this extension spec are Andrew Waterman from SciFi, John Hauser and Paolo Bozzini from Red Hat. And we also have contributors a lot of things, and primarily given a lot of feedback based on our experiences with the spec. And there have been like 5 draft revisions so far, the most recent one being released on 30th October 2019. And there will be one more, but it will be a very minor change. It will just some minor bit changes and few more instructions being added. But it won't impact the software as such more. It will be more work on the QMU side, but yeah, not on the software side. But anyways, but as per the last meeting held in the RISC-V Summit, this should most likely be the last revision, and it will be in a frozen state. And there will be a lot of organizations going ahead and implementing this in FPGA or coming up with an ASIC for it, maybe in 2020 or 2021. So what we did with the code development is that we started off very early, like mentioned over here. We started with the version 0.3 draft, went ahead and implemented it in QMU, also ported 2 hypervisors, XVisor, which is a type 1 hypervisor, and KVM, which is a type 2 hypervisor. And from the experiences gained in all these 3 things, we actually gave a lot of feedback to the community and also helped improve the RISC-V extension spec. And this timeline also shows like at what point, what patches were there on the list. So with every draft revision, we had to rebase everything, had to post again all the patches and everything. So right now, it's pretty much stable as far as software goes in general. We don't have much changes. So probably the version 0.6 draft will land in January or February soon, and maybe it will be frozen soon, actually. And then ratified, the other process, frozen to ratified, it's totally on the foundation. So moving into more details of the H extensions, actually, so it's designed to suit both type 1 as well as type 2. And these are the modified privilege levels. So as such, there is no addition of privilege mode. It's just it adds more capability to the S mode. So it so when the virtualization is on and when virtualization is off, the S modes have different capability. But basically, hypervisor and the operating system which runs inside a VM are basically running in S mode only. So that's why it's actually very suitable to both type 1 as well as type 2 hypervisors. And so hypervisor will typically run in what is called as HS mode or S mode with virtualization off. The guest kernel will run in VS mode, which is virtualized S mode, and then the guest user space will run in VU mode. And we have a lot of new CSRs, which are mostly only accessible to the HS mode, which are H CSRs, starting with H, which helps provide the hypervisor capabilities. And then we have VSCSR, which provides hypervisor to access the VM state or the CSRs of the VM. And these are the CSRs till based on the latest draft spec. The red ones highlighted over here are the ones which were added based on feedback from Western Digital and based on our efforts in co-developing the spec. So in the interest of time, I'll just skip this. So just like most of the modern architectures like ARM64, x86-64, we also have a two-stage MMU for the guest NVM, and the hypervisor just needs a single stage for itself. So we have a HS mode page table, which is just for the hypervisor, which will do the hypervisor virtual address to host physical address translation. And then for when we are running in the VM mode or guest mode, we have two page tables in active at the temp. One is the VS mode page table, which the VM programs itself. And it does the guest VA to guest virtual address to guest physical address translation. And then we have a HS mode guest page table, which is programmed by the hypervisor for the VM, which does the guest physical address to host physical address translation. And this is like a pictorial representation of the same thing and the CSRs involved. And the format of these page tables is pretty much same. There is some minor differences for 32-bit. So. And then MMI and interrupts. So guest virtual interrupts can be directly injected through the HIP CSR. So in RISC-V, all the per CPU interrupts are managed through CSRs, and the peripheral interrupts, general peripheral interrupts, are through the platform interrupt controller. So virtualizing or the guest virtual interrupts are straight away injected by updating the HIP CSR from HS mode. And we have three bits in that. So one is for the virtual external interrupt, one for virtual timer interrupt, another for virtual interprocessor interrupt. And virtual timer and virtual interprocessor interrupts will be through the SBI calls, which Atish tried to explain. So SBI is like an syscall tile interface between the M mode and the HS mode, and it's all the same interface there between HS mode and VS mode. So. And apart from this, like MMI or traps, so it's just the stage two mappings actually, or the HS mode guest table helps us to trap and emulate the guest MMIO. And the most prominent devices that we are right now emulating in software and across hypervisor is the software emulated PLIC, which is a platform level interrupt controller, and the various VoLTE devices that we are emulating. And so these are all the details about the spec, and it's really interesting to know, like, the most recent RISC architecture which added the virtualization support was ARM. So how it compares to that and how it compares to the ARM's evolution in virtualization. So in the RISC-V, we do, like I mentioned, we don't have a separate privilege mode. There is a separate privilege. More power is added to the existing privilege mode, like S mode. So that this helps, like, to run both Type 1 as well as Type 2. So in that, but in contrast to ARM, with V8.0, they actually just added EL2 exception level, which they later on ended up changing, of course. They had a separate exception level for the hypervisor itself, and then which had underscore EL2 MSRs, and the guest or VM will run in EL1 and EL0. But over here, the guest or VM will still continue to run in S mode, unmodified. So like I mentioned, ARM initially just added the EL2 mode, and then later on realized that it's not that much suitable for Type 2 hypervisors because the world switch was becoming very expensive for KVM. So what they ended up with ARM 8.1, there is a VHE extension, virtualization sub host extension coming up, so which tried to fool the kernel by allowing the host kernel or the hypervisor kernel of the KVM to run in EL2 mode, thinking as if it is running in EL1. By aliasing all the EL1 accesses from EL2 to EL2 registers. On the other end, RISC-V already takes care of this problem. We don't need to do that. And it's a bit reverse in the case of RISC-V. All the S mode accesses from the VM or guest running in VS mode map to the VS registers. So the aliasing is there in RISC-V as well, but it's at the guest or VM level and not at the hypervisor level. Then injecting virtual interrupts, like I mentioned, is just updating the HIP CSRs, and we don't need to save, restore anything, but the downside is that the PLIC, the platform level interrupt controller, is actually software emulated. So it will be through all trap and emulate. So all the virtual peripheral interrupts will be always trap and emulated. And then, but on the other hand, with ARM, they have virtualization support in Geek V2, V3, So pretty much it goes all trapless. There is no traps while accessing the Geek CPU interface registers. But they have to save, restore the LR registers when they use. So they also have kind of a downside. in the save restore path. And then virtual timers. So virtual timers is through SBI calls in RISC-V, so we don't need to save restore again. It traps. SBI call is just like a syscall or a hyper call. But in the case of ARM, we have a generic timers with virtualization support. It does not trap. So, but then again, we need to save restore the virtual timer state when we switch. Same goes for the inter-processor interrupts. We have SBI calls in RISC-V, so we don't need to save restore. Everything is there when we kind of do VM exits. But in case of ARM, this is through again the geek. So, but in case of ARM, it actually traps. So if it is geek v3, it will trap when accessing the ICC SG or EL1 registers. And again, the virtual interrupt injection is through the LR registers. So again, those will be also save restored when the VM exits happen. And lastly, nested virtualization. So nested virtualization already being considered for RISC-V H extension latest draft. So we functionally, everything is there in the RISC-V H extension already for nested virtualization. Everything will be through trap and emulate thing. There are only two bits which we need to use to enable all the necessary trapping in HS mode to enable nested virtualization. Okay, we are out of almost. And but in case of ARM, they realized it very late. So in ARM v8.3, they added special support for nested virtualization, which defined this trap and emulate mechanism for allowing nested virtualization. And eventually in ARM v8.4, they further realized the performance of the thing they defined in ARM v8.3 was not good enough. They added more accelerations for nested virtualization in ARM v8.4. Yeah, so, and this was like the pretty much detailed comparison of with ARM. We can do something similar with Power as well or with other. The point about this comparison is that most of the known issues with other well-known architectures have been already tried to cover in RISC-V H extension. And coming to just a quick summary of the feedbacks of what we have given till now. So we have proposed H-time delta CSR for guest migration, which got merged in 0.4 draft. Then we had also proposed time scaling thing for, again, migration, but it got rejected because little bit more harder to for the design folks or the implementation guys for hardware. So the simpler solution is to go for an SBI call instead, so which will be going that route now. And then there is H instruction and TVAL CSR, which was again our feedback for improving the MMI or trap performance. So we wanted to avoid the unprivileged accesses. So this got merged in 0.5 draft. And then we also had suggested separate CSRs for injecting virtual interrupts. Previously, it was everything through VSIP CSR. So this suggestion was for cleaner virtual interrupt injection and in future allowing interrupt controllers which can directly inject interrupts to guest or VM. So again, this got merged in 0.5 draft. Lastly, the future work. So on the H extension spec, it's functionally complete. It's close to free state, but then there will be always room for more performance improvement kind of things. So there could be in future incremental extensions to support like more acceleration to nested virtualization. I'm already working on a draft for it, and then there's also a suggestion to go with an more acceleration for the stage to dirty patch tracking. And so most of the improvements in H extension we see now is more related to performance and could be optional for the hardware. And in SBI specification, we need to define two SBI calls. One is for the time scaling, and another is for the parawatt time accounting for the CPU clock stealing problem. And then there are two new drafts which will be coming up, one will be the new interrupt controller in RISC-V world for supporting virtualization and MSI and other things. And there will be another IMU specific, so IMU is not there in RISC-V world now. We'll have an IMU specification as well. And anything, if any of you have really good suggestions, please feel free to send to community, join the community, and comment as well. Questions?
It's cool that Western Digital's here, and my sort of knowledge of your interest in RISC-V is basically there's going to be a lot of hard disks with little RISC-V controllers on there, right?
Yeah.
Why are you so interested in the hypervisor stuff? Is it to make RISC-V viable, or is there a use case that Western Digital has that, you know, my knowledge of Western Digital doesn't?
Yeah, so primarily our group is doing all the ecosystem things, like wherever we feel a gap in the community, we pitch in and just help it mature. It's not particularly driven by any product right now. Maybe in future it is definitely useful, or maybe Damien can answer that.
All right, so we're... Thanks.